The Nazis realized that the fine arts of painting and sculpture were not the most effective instruments for broadcasting their ideas. They needed to reach a much larger audience, and to do so, they chose the more powerful means of parades, mass meetings, a national building program, and the emerging mass media. Propaganda, which Hitler believed represented an art in itself, became a cunningly tuned engine. Radio in particular was used to introduce his values into every home. Within a year of coming to power, the party had devised an inexpensive Volksradio. Within a short time, it became the most powerful component of the propaganda machine. By the beginning of the war, there were over 12 million listeners. Not that individual listening was encouraged. Like everything else, it had to be a communal experience. In this way, any subversive discussion was blocked and people prevented from listening to foreign broadcasts. With a calculated mixture of light entertainment and German classical music, programs were designed to appeal to the majority of listeners.
Abfahren! Der Kameradschaftsdienst des Großdeutschen Rundfunks übermittelt dem Unteroffizier Herbert Haller viele liebe Grüße von seiner Ehefrau.
7 Uhr. Nachrichten des drahtlosen Dienstes. Hohe Auszeichnungen. Das Eichenlauf mit Schwertern zum Ritterkreuz des Eisernen Kreuzes erhielt gestern Hauptmann Walter Nowotny.
Hoher Klang zur Morgenstunde.
Uhr und eine Minute. Der Wehrmachtbericht. Führer Hauptquartier, das Oberkommando der Wehrmacht, gibt bekannt. Hauptquartier. Das Oberkommando der Wehrmacht gibt bekannt.
As usual, German culture stood high on the agenda. It provided a distinguished camouflage as the acceptable face of the tyrannical system. It made it acceptable to many. Even Mozart was used to give their system credibility.
An der gleichen Stelle, an der vor 150 Jahren die sterbliche Hülle Mozarts...
Baldur von Schirach lays Hitler's wreath on the spot where a century and a half ago the mortal remains of Mozart were buried.
Concerts were constantly broadcast. Beethoven's Ninth Symphony became one of the party's favorite pieces. With the exodus of so many musicians, the Nazis made sure they kept at least some of the most prominent ones in the fold. Many distinguished musicians like Wilhelm Furtwängler, Walter Gieseking, Eugen Jochum, Elisabeth Schwarzkopf agreed to perform under the Nazi flag. These filmed concerts were shown in cinemas with suitable cut-ins of the ideal audience. Richard Strauss accepted the post of the president of the Reich's Chamber of Music and gladly stepped in for Toscanini and Bruno Walter, who were no longer welcome in Bayreuth.
Es ist mir eine große Auszeichnung, das habe ich Ihnen schon so oft versichert, hier den Basketball leiten zu dürfen. Und es wäre mir eine ganz besondere Genugtuung, dass ich meine Dirigententätigkeit mit dem Basketball beschließe.
Meister, wir müssen anfangen. Ist Ihnen recht, dass wir mit dem zweiten Akt zuerst anfangen?
Jawohl, mir ist alles recht. Kommen Sie.
The festival in Bayreuth, too, was no longer for the elite. It became one of the focal points of Hitler's cultural program.
On the Führer's instruction, despite the war, this year's Bayreuth Festival is to take place. On the initiative of the National Socialist Organization, Strength Through Joy, 19,000 soldiers and German workers have been invited to participate in this solemn event. Richard Wagner's wish to turn the Bayreuth Festival into the true People's Festival has been fulfilled.
Hitler's obsession with the music of Richard Wagner was intense. Wagner's anti-Semitism, his ideas about the chosen race and the mystical blood brotherhood, had all formed Hitler's view of the world. Germany was also among the first to develop television. In 1936, German television broadcast the Olympic Games, which became not only the shop window for German fitness and athletic strength, but also for its technical excellence.
In all television viewing rooms, you too can be present at the Olympic Games.
Here too, popular stars were used to entice viewers. Programs had to be attractive. Once hooked, people couldn't escape the political messages. Joseph Goebbels, the Reich's Minister for Propaganda and Enlightenment, saw to it that everybody working in the media towed the party line.
Manchmal bis in die tiefen Nächte gefangen hält dieses deutsche Volk immer.
Oh, please, my boy, will you transmit me a message, madame? Is avec plaisir. Okay, my sweetheart, ich liebe you.
In popular music, too, the Nazis quickly replaced the many singers and actors who were forced out of the country. The Latin American singer Rosita Serrano, the Hungarian Marika Rock, the Dutch singer Johannes Hester. They all appeared regularly on screen and radio to lull people into believing that everything was as it was before, civilized and cosmopolitan. With their own superstar, Swedish singer Zara Leander, the Nazis tried to replace Marlene Dietrich, who had gone to America. Leander's great hits, A Miracle Will Happen Someday, and This Isn't the End of the World, became morale boosters in the face of approaching defeat. Everything carried the same message. We are invincible. We are the best.
Yeah.
The lead Germany had in the fields of technology, cameras, color film, motor cars and machinery was constantly stressed. It was seen as the best way of confirming Germany as a world leader and to wipe out the feeling of inferiority many felt as a result of defeat in the First World War.
Einzigartig ist der Aufstieg, den Deutschland seit dem Tage der Machtübernahme durch den Nationalsozialismus erlebt. Unsere Konstruktionen gehören zu den verbindlichsten, die es gibt. Die deutsche Arbeit steht an Genauigkeit hinter keiner anderen Arbeit des Auslandes zurück, sondern darf, wie dies unsere großen Rennerfolge beweisen, wirklich als technische Höchstleistung angesehen werden.
And once again, we're shown the strong link between the Führer and his nation. The Führer in person offers ideas, examines, and approves.
Hitler was constantly seen as the man responsible for it all. He was shown opening fairs, inspecting cars, laying foundation stones, and even digging roads. It all underlined the inflated vision he had of himself.
Neue deutsche Reichsautostraßennetz ist nicht nur in der Anlage das gewaltigste, was es dieser Art auf der Welt gibt, das verbindlichste, das es gibt. Es wird auch mehr als alles Übrige mithelfen, die deutschen Gaue, die deutschen Lande miteinander zu verbinden und in eine Einheit zu zwingen.
Unsere Rundfunkfreunde hören lieber von eurem Schaffen.
So? Dann sagen sie ihnen aber, dass wir Brücken bauen, wie sie noch nie da waren.
Ja. Und dass er ihre mitschafft bei uns.
Ja. Und dass wir alle wissen, worum es geht. Ja. Richtig.
England schreibt.
The British press says the German motorways are second to none and lead the world.
Das deutsche Straßennetz setzt Deutschland an die erste Stelle unter allen Ländern der Welt. Holland.
The Dutch say we are filled with admiration for this great German achievement. Yugoslavia. As the pyramids record the history of the pharaohs, so too the motorways will remind the German people forever of the most extraordinary figure in its history. A man of the people who, single-handed, with no other help, by virtue of his own will, has created a new German Reich.
Even today, much of the Hitler myth is based on his achievement with the motorways. They were another symbol of the glorious and relentless National Socialist movement. The building of such an inventive and vast motorway network was politically and strategically motivated. It was meant to provide easy access for the military to conquer the rest of Europe. It was also the best means of giving people work and of getting the economy going. The motorways were an extraordinary technical and aesthetic tour de force. With their stunning bridges and sweeping embankments, they were remarkable examples of modern architecture. Built by the best architects, they also blended into the landscape.
A ribbon of stone doth span our land. A people hath built with all its might, stands ready now for a new fight. The Führer's mind did think it out. A faithful people brought it about. A triumph of power. The work is done. The first battle has been won. A people free of want and shame. The future calls with higher aim. The Führer gives us faith again.
Der Glaube jetzt geweckt. Der Zukunft ist ein großes Ziel gesteckt.
The Nazis favored two architectural styles, neither of them original. The first one was monumental, based on neoclassicism. The second one was a country style, reflecting the arts and crafts idea. Mostly used for mass housing and youth hostels, it fitted in with the feeling for the value of tradition.
Youth hostels, in keeping with the landscape and with tradition, have been built for our youth, who on foot like to explore their Heimat, their homeland.
Not that modern architecture was widely accepted. The controversy over the modern flat roof as against the traditional gable raged among architects long before Hitler came to power. Here too, the Nazis had an easy task. They exploited popular fear of anything modern as they did in the visual arts. Many housing estates, Siedlungen of the Weimar Republic, had been built by famous architects, some of them defenders of the modern movement. The Nazis did not reject the work which was done by these pioneers, but they did replace their modern outlook with a cult for folksy architecture. The pitched roof and shutters became powerful symbols.
Homes for the working man as they've never existed before. Generous and centralized planning everywhere. The German Workers' Front fulfills a building program in line with the will of the Führer. We create homes which are in harmony with the landscape and which are traditional. Peaceful places which make men strong again.
The individual home with its little garden was also seen as the best way to encourage people to have children and to weld people into one nation. The Nazis' rejection of the city and their love for the small town cashed in on popular attitudes and played on the desires felt by many for a pre-industrial age. Architecture, films, paintings and songs all praised the virtue of the Heimat, the homeland which had to be defended by the entire nation.
Wer bist du eigentlich? Bist du aus dem Dorf?
Nein, ich bin fremd hier. Ich habe keine Heimat.
Keine Heimat? Das ist aber schwer für dich. Eine Heimat haben ist höchstes Glück. Sieh mal, da drüben am anderen Ufer, weit, da liegt meine Heimat. Die solltest du mal sehen. Die solltest du mal sehen mit ihren großen Bauernhöfen und den weiten Wiesen und den schwarzen Wäldern und den Feldern dort, diese weiten, endlosen Felder.
Sie muss sehr schön sein, deine Heimat. Aber warum bist du dann geflohen?
Geflohen? Ich bin nicht geflohen.
Wir haben gekämpft und ich wurde verfolgt.
Dann hat sie wohl sehr viele Feinde, deine Heimat.
Gehabt, ja. Aber jetzt sind wir mitten im Kampf, um sie zu vertreiben. Und deswegen muss ich unbedingt so schnell wie möglich herüber. Weißt du, jeder Einzelne wird drüben gebraucht. Jeder.
In remote areas of the Reich, Hitler built his Ordensburgen. The Hitler training schools, or Ordensburgen, were elite institutions for the racially pure. Imitations of medieval fortresses, they were built of stone and timber. In the image of its inhabitants, the architecture was stern, masculine. It stood for power and eternal values. Every facet of the buildings was the expression of Nazi ideology. The decor was simple and functional. It all helped to form the character. There were rooms to celebrate and to assemble in. The ritualized routines helped to forge a feeling of community and to extinguish any opportunity for self-doubt and questioning. The party looked after you.
Here are a few glimpses into the life of these Adolf Hitler schools, evening concerts. Education in the fine arts. The best of German youth has been chosen to be shaped in these Ordensburgen to become decent and courageous human beings.
In der Kunstschmiede.
Sword making.
In den Schlafsälen herrscht peinlich.
In the dormitories, scrupulous order and tidiness reign.
It was above all the young Hitler tried to seduce with his cultural program.
Ich denke, du kommst erst heute Abend. Na, wie hat's dir gefallen? Nur das war kolossal. Na nun, was hat denn der Stoppel so Kolossales mit euch angestellt?
Stoppel?
Was ist denn, Heine?
Du Mutter, ich war doch bei den anderen.
Bei welchen anderen?
Na, bei den Jungs mit dem Hakenkreuz.
Doch nicht bei den Nazis.
Doch.
Junge, Junge.
Du Mutter, die sind aber gar nicht so schlimm.
Ach.
Die haben abgekocht, getont und geschwommen und gesungen. Ein Lied haben die gesungen, sag ich dir. Und wie ging das noch? Das habe ich doch vergessen. Unser Fahne. Warte mal, jetzt habe ich's. Unsere Fahne flattert uns voran. In die Zukunft dient der Mann für Mann. Wir marschieren für Hitler durch Nacht und durch Not mit der Fahne der Jugend für Freiheit und Frieden. Unsere Fahne flattert uns voran. Unsere Fahne ist die neue Zeit. Unsere Fahne.
Aber was singst du denn da? Das singt doch die Nazis, Mensch. Du hast ja das gelernt, Mann!
Du, lass doch den Jungen, ja, der wird es
einfach aufgeschnappt. Was heißt das, wenn hier was gesungen wird, dann singst du... Völker, hört die Signale auf zum letzten... Warum singst du nicht mit, was? Na los! Auf zum letzten Gefecht! Du singst ja nicht, was? Kannst du nicht, was? Du kannst nicht, was? Dann sing mal! Völker, hört die... Signale, auf zum letzten, kannst du nicht singen, du? Da wächst ja bald weg, du. Völker, du.
Völker,
hör. Die Signale, auf zum letzten, Gefecht.
Völker, hör. Die Signale, ja. Auf zum letzten, Gefecht.
Die Internationale erkämpft das Menschenrecht.
The love for the folksy was not the preserve of the populace. Hitler and the party elite, too, loved the Bavarian look. Hitler built himself a country house in Berchtesgaden, where he received foreign guests and lived with Eva Braun. Martin Bormann and Hermann Göring also had country houses here. Most of them were linked by underground tunnels. The house, known as the Eagle's Nest, was built as a private retreat on the summit of Kehlstein, 2,000 meters up. To reach the Eagle's Nest, which was Hitler's and Eva Braun's tea house, you had to walk into a vaulted passage hewn into the heart of the mountain. A luxurious lift took the visitor 150 meters up to the summit. Here, the guests felt they were in the presence of the leader of the world, a man towering above the rest. Some buildings escaped this folkloric treatment. Factories and industrial buildings did not have to be built in the fascist style. They used modern technology. The Air Force, which considered itself the aristocracy among the services, resisted traditional styles and saw to it that its buildings were modern. While Hitler took little interest in mass housing, his involvement in public buildings was total. He saw himself as the nation's artist, and above all, its architect. He liked to show off his architectural knowledge. He liked to be photographed with plans and models. He believed architecture was the finest of the arts. It was the one art which did not disappoint him and from which new developments could be expected. The 19th century had developed a variety of architectural styles which expressed a general nostalgia for a stable traditional world. Neoclassical, neo-Gothic, and even neo-Egyptian elements satisfied these longings. Hitler, too, preferred buildings which were already programmed this way. The Walhalla at Regensburg and the Befreiungshalle at Kelheim were two 19th century monuments which Hitler occupied for his own ends. They became places of pilgrimage for the party. Hitler came here to lay a wreath in honor of Anton Bruckner, another appropriation of a cultural hero of the past. The architecture's impressive sense of antiquity and of continuity was copied in many of the classical buildings of the Third Reich. Munich was to be the capital of the movement, the new center for the party. The Königsplatz, with its neoclassical buildings, was redesigned to become one of the central shrines of Nazi ritual worship. Hitler's favorite architect, Paul Ludwig Troost, built two large party buildings. The party administration building and the Führer building formed one side of the square. They're almost identical. They carry all the hallmarks of the style the Nazis adopted for their official buildings. The massive limestone porticos, the eagles and wreathed swastikas. There was the obligatory Führer balcony from which the great statesman architect could look down upon his work and his people. The heavy cornice and rows of windows emphasized the horizontal lines, giving it a fortress-like appearance. The Führer building was for official receptions and has red marble floors and two huge staircases. Originally, the walls were hung with tapestries and covered with paintings. The two adjoining temples became the altars of the new movement. The most powerful aspect of the Nazi propaganda machine was the mass meeting. Hitler, the master of the crowd, entered along an avenue through the crowd, a via triumphalis of living bodies, as Goebbels described it.
Oskar Körner! Hans-Erich Rickmann!
The last roll call of the dead was held in front of the temples of honor. Present, chanted the crowd, a macabre pastiche of the Stations of the Cross. The appropriation of the Christian liturgy was a recurrent Nazi device. A complex visual arrangement of uniforms and group formations was meticulously choreographed. A fascination with geometry, with structured patterns. People formed groups as though molded by an invisible will. A new communal body language was created, which synchronized thousands, moving to the same beat. Forming sculptures, standing to attention, raising arms to give the party salute, a sinister ballet, a massive celebration which lulled the brain and led to a kind of ecstasy. Then there followed Hitler's lonely ascent to a position of solitary splendor, overlooking a sea of red flags, isolated as a god. These rallies were Hitler's Gesamtkunstwerk. In them, he created his ultimate stage productions. Troost also built Munich's new gallery. It was praised as a temple of German art, one of the monuments of a new age. The temple form obviously recalled the prestige of a culture which reached back to antiquity. The neoclassical structure was a heavier version of Schinkel's old museum in Berlin, built in the 19th century. Hitler wrote, "These works of ours shall also be eternal, magnificent evidence of civilization in granite and marble. These buildings of ours should not be treated as contemporary, nor of the year 2000, but instead, like the cathedrals of our past, they shall stretch into the millennia to come."
So, Jungs, nun wollen wir uns das mal ansehen. Herr Hitler,
Herr Hitler,
darf man mal näher sehen?
Natürlich, warum denn nicht?
Das ist aber eine schwere Arbeit.
Die ist auch schön
und überdauert die Zeiten.
Es ist ein altes Handwerk.
An so einem Bau mitzuarbeiten, das wäre schön.
Jedes Mal erfüllt es mich mit stiller Freude, wenn ich die fertigen Bauwerke sehe und ich weiß, da, der und der Stein, das ist meine Arbeit.
Nuremberg, until its destruction, was one of the best-preserved medieval cities in Germany. Its appeal to Hitler's idea of patriotism was obvious. It was here that he built the giant stadiums, the architectural framework for his mass meetings. A huge area of 30 square kilometers, the size of a small town, was planned by Troost. On his death, it was handed over to Albert Speer. It was to be the largest complex of its kind in the world. A few figures suffice to give an idea of the size of this megalomaniac undertaking. The Zeppelin Field had an arena for 240,000 spectators. The March Field was supposed to hold 500,000 visitors. The buildings became crowd containers, stages for the great events, and the people were part of the architecture, like the sculptures, flagpoles, the grandstands, and the braziers. The massive architecture inflated the myth of the Führer into gigantic proportions. The huge Congress Hall built by the architect Ludwig Ruff was never finished. The architecture recalls that of the Colosseum, giving it a borrowed sense of permanence. Words like austerity, sobriety, Nordic were the favorite words used to describe these new buildings. They were securing Hitler's power for all time. Inside, a huge theater and assembly hall were planned with the latest technology in lighting and heating. In the giant roof, a huge skylight was to open to the sky. Each of the major German cities was to have a giant arena for mass assemblies. Hitler commissioned the architect Werner Marsch to build a sports stadium in Berlin with a capacity of 100,000. As in Nuremberg, it was more than a mere sports arena. It was a ritual assembly. Built in German stone, quarried from all over the country, it was another expression of a communal effort. It was Hitler's idea to decorate all parts of the stadium with the works of his favorite sculptors, Wackerle, Breker, Thorak, and Kolbe. Their work reinforced the pervasive political message of the place. ideals and signposts, they extolled the virtues of the German race. Determination, health, and heroism. The Olympic Games of 1936 were a suitable occasion to parade this new architecture and sculpture. Hitler opened the games in front of an impressed international crowd. A choir sang the Olympic hymn, especially composed by Germany's most prestigious and famous composer, Richard Strauss. And many, not just in Germany, were struck by the displays of vitality and culture. In 1938, Hitler commissioned Albert Speer to build a new chancellery. Contemporary critics praised its austerity, its German character, its imposing Prussian style.
Der gewaltige Bau der neuen Reichskanzlei dient auch den großen repräsentativen Empfängen der Regierung. Der erste Staatsakt in diesem Hause war der Neujahrsempfang der ausländischen Diplomaten durch den Führer Großdeutschlands.
The imposing building of the new chancellery is to be used for official receptions. For its inauguration, the Führer of the Greater German Reich receives foreign diplomats, the Hungarian ambassador, the ambassador of Japan, the Italian ambassador.
Before entering Hitler's chancellery, one drove into a great well-like courtyard to be used for parades. The entrance was flanked by huge columns and was crowned by an eagle and swastika. On either side stood two large statues by Arno Breker, the party and the army, guardians of the chancellery and of the whole nation. In contrast to the stark exterior, was the flamboyant and theatrical interior, a reflection of the nouveau riche taste of the Nazi elite. Elaborate window dressing borrowed from a feudal society. The interiors of official buildings were of calculated splendor, designed to stun the visitor and to force him into subservience. Everything, the size of the rooms, the large staircases, the giant decorations, the chandeliers proclaimed that here people of a superior rank lived and worked.
In the Führer's office, noble materials provide the serene but forceful color scheme which he loves for his working environment. Great thoughts are born here, a place for decisive conversations.
Even administration buildings had to express the ideology of the regime. Its architectural order was the expression of a disciplined nation. Little produced in those years had any feeling of joy or of spontaneity. Like Hitler's speeches, his architecture was inflated, repetitious, banal. The architects used the language of classicism, but little was left of the measured design of the great architects of the 19th century. Most of the architecture of the Third Reich has no sense of scale. Public buildings became more and more overbearing. They dwarfed the people and forced them into submission. This is the Academy of the National Socialist German Workers' Party in Bavaria. It was never built, but it gives an idea of the shape of things to come. These massive buildings were designed by Hermann Giesler. Their brutality has seldom been matched. They inspired fear and fascination and continue to do so. As he became more powerful, Hitler lost interest in individual buildings. He developed a taste for things on a much larger scale. While the German cities sank into ruins one by one, Hitler dreamed up larger and larger building schemes. It was one of the many contradictions, an urge to build and to destroy at the same time. Hitler loved Rome and Paris, but Berlin was to outshine both in size and splendor. Early one morning, shortly after the occupation of France, in the company of his favorites, the sculptor Arno Breker and the architects Albert Speer and Hermann Giesler, he drove through the deserted streets of the French capital, the conqueror's flying visit. It inspired his plans for the new German capital. 19th century city was to be destroyed and replaced by a new one, a massive project with a 39-kilometer highway at its core.
The East-West Highway, which the shaping hand of our Führer has cut through the chaotic development of the old city, is an expression of his far-sighted genius.
There was no place for modesty in this regime. The main avenue, flanked by great official buildings, was to create the imperial perspectives worthy of a world power. It ended in a triumphal arch. Hitler spent hours gazing entranced at the models Speer had made for him. They stood floodlit in the Reich Chancellery. There, Hitler indulged his fantasies as the great patron of an architecture which would outdo Babylon and Luxor. His excessive self-love meant he had to outdo the rest of history. But like so many of Hitler's dreams, these great plans remained on the drawing board.
Nach einem sich über Jahre erstreckenden Plan.
A gigantic building program will change the face of Berlin. It is the result of the National Socialists' determination. On the facades of these buildings which surround the great circus, one can read the impressive clarity and the creative spirit which will be the hallmark of the architecture of the Third Reich.
There was to be a giant hall for 200,000 people, based, like the Triumphal Arch, on Hitler's early drawings. It was crowned by the Eagle of the Reich, holding a swastika. The Nazis' main sculptor, Arno Breker, was asked to design a fountain 126 meters in diameter with a figure of Apollo 6 meters high. Goebbels wrote, "Berlin will become the capital in absolute control of Europe, or even of the world." Newsreels and documentaries did not deal with reality either. They too played their part in the machinery of make-believe. During the war, the propaganda ministry employed over 400 cameramen to maintain the image of a great and victorious German nation. Skilled cameramen and film editors made use of their experience in feature films. They were made with technical sophistication and stylistic innovations. Filmmakers approved by the powerful Organization of Enlightenment and Propaganda under Joseph Goebbels manipulated people by selective editing and sharp contrasting images learned from their teacher Leni Riefenstahl, whose films Olympiad and Triumph of the Will were the most skillful and most telling examples of Nazi propaganda.
34-35 wurde Leni Riefenstahl für den Film vom Reichsparteitag in Nürnberg Triumph des Willens zuerkannt. Bringt in monumentalen, nie gesehenen Bildern das hinreißende Geschehen unseres politischen Lebens. Ist die große filmische Vision des Führers, der hier zum ersten Male bildlich in nie gesehener Eindringlichkeit in die Erscheinung tritt.
Riefenstahl's cameraman, Walter Frenz, shot the sailing event in her Olympic film. It demonstrates the technique used in propaganda films. Camera angles gave the audience the feeling of actually sitting in the boats. marathon, the use of close-ups of feet and shadow let the spectator feel the loneliness of the runner. His fatigue is transmitted by the use of slow motion. The musical crescendo indicates that victory is approaching. Actual war reporting was treated like feature film. News cameramen accompanied the Navy into the battle. The involvement of the audience was guaranteed.
Wieder ein Treffer! Achtung, Stromgeräusche in 60 Grad! Sie kommen näher! Ein Zerstörer jagt das Unterseeboot!
The frequent close-ups of earnest German faces to highlight a Goebbels or Hitler speech was a further filmic device to make people identify with the event. We've seen these faces reappearing in film after film during speeches, concerts and rallies. Film was cunningly edited. Note how the word "I believe" will fall on a devoted face, the word "battle" on a soldier's.
Noch vorgestern sagte er mir, ich glaube so fest daran, dass wir diese Krise bewältigen werden. Und ich glaube so fest daran, dass wenn wir unsere neuen Offensivarmeen hineinwerfen, dass wir den Feind schlagen und zurückjagen werden. Und ich glaube so fest, dass wir eines Tages den Sieg an unserer Fahnen heften werden, wie ich je in meinem Leben an etwas fest geglaubt habe.
Simple filmic devices were used to drive the messages home. New soundtracks were added to heighten the event. Another device was the balletic display of military might, a technique also exploited in the mass marches at Nuremberg. The dark and sinister sides of the war were omitted. Deportations of Jews were not allowed to be shown. This footage was never released, but kept in a secret archive. The presentation of the Jew was actually reserved for feature films like Jud Zeus or The Rothschilds.
Muss nur klar sehen. Also, hier in London sitzen Sie und Sie. Wir beide. Hier nach Wien kommt mein Bruder Salomon.
Salomon Rothschild.
Richtig. Hier nach Neapel setzen wir meinen Bruder Karl.
Karl Rothschild.
Also. Wir passen Sie mal auf. London. Wien. Neapel. Hier in Frankfurt ist unser Stammhaus. In Gibraltar sitzt England.
Na, was liegt da?
Jerusalem.
Wollen Sie da auch eine Filiale gründen?
Umgekehrt, mein lieber Herr. Die Filialen von Jerusalem sind wir.
Despite the increasing retreat of the German troops, the soldier was still seen as the hero. Defeat was reserved for the Russians, like these Russian prisoners of war.
Auch das sind Sowjetsoldaten.
After the fall of Stalingrad, the truth of the death and the suffering of German troops could no longer be hidden from the public. 1.25 million German soldiers had died in Stalingrad alone. The pictures the families saw at home were those of the troops defeated by the elements in the icy winter not those of the Germans defeated by the enemy. Everything was tailored to serve the delusion. These guns were actually destroyed shortly after the film was shot, and most of the soldiers were dead. But when it was shown, Goebbels' newsreel, with the help of music by Liszt, became a celebration of victory. In 1942, when Hitler's troops were experiencing bitter defeat on the Russian front, Veit Harlan, the regime's star director, shot one of the most expensive films the Nazis ever made, The Great King, the story of Frederick the Great, one of the historical role models the Nazis repeatedly dragged out of their historical repertoire to invite comparison with Hitler, the great leader. The central figure was played by the famous Otto Gebühr. Some of his lines were taken directly from Hitler's speeches. It was a call for endurance.
Deutschland ist in einer furchtbaren Krisis. Wir leben in einer Epoche, die alles entscheiden und das Gesicht von Europa verändern wird. Vor ihrer Entscheidung muss man furchtbare Zufälle bestehen. Aber nach ihrer Entwicklung klärt sich der Himmel auf und wird heiter. Und wie groß auch die Zahl meiner Feinde ist, ich vertraue auf meine gute Sache und die bewundernswerte Tapferkeit der Truppen. Marschall bis zum jüngsten Soldaten. Die Armee greift an. Also schreibe mir auf.
In the final scene, King Frederick visits his people. The woman has taken over her husband's work. The country rebuilds itself by a communal effort.
Wer hat die Mühle dort aufgebaut?
Ihr alle, Majestät.
Ach, sie ist es. Wer ist denn der Müller?
Ich, Majestät.
Stehst du nun ganz allein?
Nein, Majestät.
Stehe allein.
The king, divine and solitary, just like Hitler, contemplates the fate of his country. The film ends with a montage of favorite themes we've seen before in painting, housing, and in sculpture. Mother and child, the farmer plowing his field, the abundant crops, the endlessly repeated lies handed out again and again. The real Germany lay in ruins. The fictional one lived in peace and prosperity. Harlan's Kolberg was made in the last year of the war. It tells the story of the resistance of the city of Kolberg against Napoleon. Much of the dialogue was written by Goebbels himself. It was an invitation to collective suicide. When Hitler realized that the Germans could no longer win the war, they ceased to be his people. He condemned his own country to a national death.
Es hat keinen Sinn mehr. Wir können die Stadt nicht halten.
Und?
Übergabe.
Ach, wir in Magdeburg. Erfurt. Kestrin. Spandau. Alles ist umsonst gewesen. Das Ende. Schande. Wir sind hier groß geworden. Wir kennen hier jeden Stein, jede Ecke, jedes Haus. Och, wir lassen doch nicht los. Und wenn wir uns mit unseren Nägeln in unseren Boden einkrallen, an unsere Stadt, wir lassen nicht los. Nee. Da muss man uns die Hände einzeln abpacken oder uns erschlagen. Einen Namen abpacken. Ich hab's ja auch unserem König versprochen. Lieber unter den Trümmern begraben als kapitulieren.
So wollte ich's von Ihnen hören, Nettelbeck. Jetzt können wir zusammen sterben.
By 1945, ideology had led to the death of 55 million people.